The following program was made possible thanks to the generous support of our Kickstarter backers.
Well, first Holmes was born, and he got fat, bald, and tired.
Sup, Holmes?
Beware your host, Jonathan Holmes!
Hello, Jonathan Holmes, here with Robert Yang. Straight in from New York City? Is that you, Robert?
Yeah, it's me in the flesh. Well, it's not really,
you.
But...
And I see pictures of like old-timey baby and a couple and stuff behind you.
And not my family, in case it's not obvious. staying at a friend's house on the Jersey Shore right now, actually.
Oh, cool. Is it somebody from the Jersey Shore? Like, Snooki?
Yes, I believe it is Snooki. Snooki.
Was it ever right? Snooki, or did I just make that up in my mind?
Her friends probably call her Snooki.
Yeah. And you are one of our friends, so here we are.
Obviously.
How was your morning going, and your afternoon, your whole weekend?
It's going good. Went to the beach, as you do on the Jersey Shore. And then came right back here early from the beach to do this lovely show.
Oh, that's so nice of you. And I've been excited about getting you on the show for a while. I think I first heard about you sometime in early 2014. I know I've been following you for a little bit as earlier last year, it seemed like you were focused a lot more on the academic side of game design and that sort of thing. Not that you aren't now, but that's how I knew you.
Yeah,
but lately, ever since December 2014, you've been known as the guy who's willing to talk about penises in video games. Isn't that neat?
Yeah, I think I just... I wouldn't say gave up, but I would say changed my direction or something. I don't know.
Well, how long, just so I'm aware, because I'm not always the smartest guy, believe it or not, how long have you been at this game development thing?
I think I started doing a lot of like Half-Life 1 modding and stuff while I was in high school. And then from there I started working on this mod called Black Mesa Source, and did some more modding stuff. And then I got more into Unity stuff and started making more standalone things. And now I'm what you see here.
Sure. I think Radiator was one of the first mods of yours I was aware of, a Half-Life 2 mod, which is very narrative focused. It's almost, if I remember it correctly, it's been a little while since I've played it, but I don't remember causing any real trouble in that game. I just remember feeling sometimes a little troubled, but not like though I was in any sort of violent trouble in any way.
Yeah, they were pretty narrative. They're all kind of quiet. They were kind of contemporaries of the original Dear Esther and like the original Stanley Parable and stuff, that whole kind of experimental Half-Life 2 mod scene kind of thing. Except they went on to make millions of dollars, and I'm here not with $1 million. But it's okay. I'm not salty or bitter at all.
No, you don't sound it. Not at all. And are you in college, or you work through a college?
Right now I teach. I got my master's a few years ago at Parsons School for Design in New York City. And now I teach for them, and I teach at the NYU Game Center, as well as the Interactive Digital Media IDM program at NYU Poly.
Oh, wow. Cool. So hopefully that does well to pay the bills. Those are nice schools.
They're nice day jobs, yeah.
Yeah, sounds like it. Did you ever imagine that you would end up teaching any aspect of game design as a college professor?
A little. In my undergrad days, I went to undergrad at University of California, Berkeley. And there they have no games programs at all. So I actually started, they have these things where students can lead their own classes and stuff. So as an undergrad, I was actually already teaching games classes, even though I didn't really know that much. But still, I kind of just started these classes up as like a, you know, democratic education. That's what's called there.
That's really cool. But that takes, I'd imagine, quite a bit of guts putting yourself out there to instruct takes some level of confidence and also excitement about connecting with people and helping people. You have to have a passion, I'd imagine, to make that step. Did it pay teaching as undergrad?
No, that was free, and it's actually been pretty. It's still weaponized as like free labor to cover up the holes that the university can't cover it by itself. So it's actually kind of bad and exploitative, but I liked it for what it was and found it empowering.
Yeah, that is the world of video games, isn't it? Everything from writing about them to doing YouTube videos about them to making them. There's a lot of us who are super passionate about it and will do it for free, even though maybe we should have been paid. It's not the first time I've heard that story. So what do you think it was about video games that had you passionate enough about them to teach those courses for free?
I feel like I actually don't like playing video games so much as making them for some reason. Like, I play video games, so I have an excuse to like make video games almost. It's just really amazing when you're like making this like thing that you don't really know what it is, but you're still making it. My boss, Frank Lance, he says video games are, oh, there goes my clock.
Snooki's clock.
He says video games are like operas made of battleships or something. It's a really beautiful soundbite. I'm not doing it justice. But it's that's kind of like how making video games is like this weird thing that you're coding and you're being really specific with your code, but you still don't really know what you're making. And I find that kind of like uncertainty kind of exciting, I guess.
It is it has been called something of a romance that people feel with whatever they're making, when what they're making sometimes has its own intelligence. It's got its own potential feedback loops. It's got its own surprising reactions to what you do with it. Some developers have told me, a bit romantic. They feel like they fall in love with the games that they're making. And then when the game's over, when they're done making it anyway, it's incredibly depressing. I've heard that from, I can't even think of how many developers have told me.
Oh yeah, postpartum depression is very real.
Yeah, absolutely. Real. Have you had it with any of your games?
Yeah, I think first off, like just the idea that anyone finishes making any game is always like a miracle. Kind of. Like, even if it's, like, a crappy game that you did it in 3 days, the fact that you, like, finished it and, like, pushed it out into the world, you know, that's what's just, it's, like, kind of, like, amazing. And you always feel, it's that really high kind of feeling, and then you just kind of settle down and your adrenaline kind of drops a little. But it's okay, you know, you come to peace with that, and it's not that bad in the end.
Sure, and it sounds like it's enough to drive you to keep making games, because just in the past 7 months, I think, that I know of, you've put out 4 different games or more?
I'd say four, yeah.
Yeah, pretty amazing. So you're able to jump right back into it, at least some of the time. Lately you have been.
Yeah, it's very unusual. I'm actually wondering when I'm going to run out of that. Yeah, it's weird to be finishing things. I think it's because I was just tired of not finishing things. And then I gave myself pretty, like, formal constraints about the things I would be making. Like, okay, this is just going to be about spanking a dude. And now I'm not going to add a day-night cycle. I'm not going to add some kind of open-world mission system, right? You're going to spank this guy, and then the game will be done.
I think you're referring to Hurt Me Plenty, is that right?
Yes.
Yeah. That game really, it seemed like, from how I pay attention to what's going on in video games, and we all pay attention to that differently, but it seemed to me that that game woke people up to what you were doing quite a bit. I think I even read about it on Kotaku.com, which is a video game blog.
Yeah, I'd say it's my most famous one or popular one right now. It was my first one. Yeah, that one did pretty well. That one got a lot of coverage. That one, but got picked up by a lot of like spanking and kink websites too. Really big in Japan. In this, because it like tied into this meme, I'm told, in Japan, it's called, like, Gachi Machi or something. The whole, like, naked muscle men kind of, like, wrestling kind of meme. So they really loved the idea that you could spank a guy. I think, like, half my hits were probably from Japan, actually.
Really? What I think a lot of people expected. So many people generalize Japanese game culture as being a lot of sexualization of women. But in general, from what I know, sexualizing people and sex in media that's fantasy or video game focused in Japan, there's not the same sort of taboo that I think Westerners often have, because cartoons in the Western subconscious are still very attached to Disney and children, and video games ended up being, to a lot of people, just an offshoot of cartoons, what with all the cartoon mascots of the 80s and 90s, Mario and Sonic and whatnot. So you put sexuality in a game and people think, oh, you're corrupting the children. But we all know, hopefully we all know now in 2015, that games are far from just for kids. They're for grown men that want to spank grown men sometimes.
Exactly. Or women who want to spank grown men. Everyone can have fun.
Absolutely they can. But the gachi machi thing, that I'm not an expert on that, but I have talked about it a little bit in the past in reference actually to Rhythm Heaven Fever. I don't know if you've played that.
Oh, not familiar. Oh, it has muscle dudes in it? Wow.
Well, it was embraced by those in the gachi machi scene, from what I know, because there is a particular mini game in Rhythm Heaven Fever where a wrestler flexes and sweats. Uh-huh. And it's cute, and it doesn't seem sexualized at all. He's not particularly sexy. But somebody replaced that flexing wrestler with a gachi machi icon. I'm not sure of his name, but he wears a thong. And he's
Yeah, there's one particular guy.
Yeah, you know the guy. He's seen around. Then that just blew up in that scene. And then I ended up writing a little bit about it, and people, unsurprisingly, got quite angry at me because they said, don't glorify gachi machi because it's making a joke out of genuine lust for men. It's treating it like it's a farce. Is that something that you've encountered? People thinking that your work is farcical and meant to be laughed at instead of a genuine tribute to lusting after men?
That's the difficult part, I would say, about making gay-themed or sexually charged kind of gay games, video games, are often likened to like a conversation or something, or some kind of like participatory art, where you're sharing the art with the player in some sense. So when like some kind of creepy homophobic YouTuber guys get a hold of my games and they kind of go like, oh god, am I spanking this guy? Oh, gross, it does hurt a little, and that's kind of one of the reasons I don't watch a lot of the Let's Plays, actually, of my games. It does kind of come across as homophobic to me, which sucks, but my personal take is that I guess I have to accept it in this weird way because I'm trying to share this with a player, and if you share it with a player, you have to be, I guess, I have to steel myself for players being gross and inappropriate.
Mm-hmm. Once it's out there, you can't control how people accept it, and then hopefully enough people feel the way from it and use. Well, that, I guess it's different than the direction I was just going in. I was about to do the old platitude of once it's out there, you can't control it, people take it. But it's not as simple as that anymore, because people are taking your game and transforming it into their own form of entertainment through Let's Plays. Like, they're making maybe as much money, if not more, than you have off your own games.
I'd say a lot more.
Probably a lot more, yeah.
But that's okay. That's kind of why I said all these games that pay what you want. I mean, partly because no one would, like, pay money for them probably, but also because I kind of feel like games, I put a lot of like production value into these games. Like, they use some technically sophisticated like graphics technology stuff, but then I also want to give it away for free. like, in a way, I kind of want to, like, disrupt... Oh, God, I didn't want to say that. I kind of want to change how, like, people think of value in games. I'm hoping games, if to truly be, like, acknowledged as, like, art or something, they should be acknowledged as in a tradition also of, like, public art. Like, art is this public good that people should invest in, and then it should be made freely available to people. I understand a lot of makers and artists can't do that, and that's okay, and they should charge for their work. But I'm in a wonderful position where I have some gainful employment, so I can kind of just give away this other stuff for free and make it freely available.
Huh, interesting. It's I'm sure you've been in quite a few heated arguments about this, because on one hand, I've talked to so many people who have said, well, a Twine game should be a thought to have at least $5, maybe even $10 amount of worth, whatever that means. So putting those on Steam, I don't know if you know the creator of, oh my God, I can't believe I'm blanking on the name. She's such a neat person too, Nina Freeman. I don't know why I blanked on her. She put some of her games up on Steam, one of which you can beat in 30 seconds, it'll be over. And she put it up there for free, but people still got angry at her because she spoke out a little bit about Steam's recent refund policy, where if you play a game, I think for less than 2 hours, or maybe it's three, you can get your money back for it. And there's games that have a ton of worth that are going to be memorable, that are going to affect people, that are going to make them laugh, that are going to make them think, that are going to be over in way less than 2 hours. And those the developers are now running the risk of making zero money because all of their games might be refunded.
Yeah, I would say I'm a fan of some kind of like scaled refund policy for like short games, because I think that 2 hour cutoff for like refunds does kind of encourage a certain idea of what games are worth or what a game is supposed to like provide. And I like making short things, and I can actually finish making short things. So, I would say, I hope, Valve develops a more kind of comprehensive refund policy in the future. But in the meantime, I'll be kind of patient, because I guess it's hard to, like, create an economy or something. So I guess I'll give them a little bit of time on this or something.
Yeah, I think that Valve gets a lot of hostility thrown their way, as though they are intentionally, like, making developers' lives worse. And I don't think that's the case. As I know Valve, and I don't know them very well, but the people I know who know them better than I do say, they never expected Steam to be this big. It wasn't this big in like 2008 or 2009 even. It's grown exponentially in the past few years as computers in general are becoming a place where more people think video games can be played or should be played. Mm-hmm. And they're just trying to keep up, poor guys. I feel for them. Hopefully they'll figure it out. They're basically like the president of video games. And they're like running this country of all like PC games.
I don't remember electing them, but that's okay.
No. They were elected by all the money people gave them, because they get, I can't remember how much they get on each Steam game sale, if it's percents or what.
Yeah, I'd say like it's like 30%.
Which yeah, it's relatively high. Yeah. Huh. Do you think you'd ever want to put your games on consoles? Just last week, we were talking to Ben Shostak, a very nice man, Destructoid community veteran. And he's like, I'm going to put more games on the Wii U, I think. And his game, High Strangeness, actually sold better on the Wii U than it did on Steam. And he's like, and I'd be looking to help people port their stuff as well. I would freaking flip out if I got a Hurt Me Plenty, Succulent, Stick Shift, and the most recent Cobra Club, like a 4-pack for like $5 on the Wii U. That would be incredible. You would have no competition.
Yeah. No, yeah, I guess I wouldn't have competition. That would be cool. I don't know, doing stuff with consoles is just so difficult. Like, you have to go through all this like QA certification stuff. Like, if you like you always have to have button graphics in certain corners, and the A button always has to be blue or green or something in this. So I don't know if the opportunity comes up. If they want to send me a dev kit or something, I guess I'll go for it. But I don't think I'll like seek it out. Plus, I'm already like satisfied just from anecdotes. Like I have a lot of colleagues who show my games in their classes, and they report that the students' like brains explode or something. Which is cool. So I don't know. I'm already okay with that kind of reaction. I don't think I need like full 100% like cultural reach or anything. I'm okay with where I am, I guess.
Sure. Well, it's wonderful to be satisfied where you are and where you're going. Oh, can you still hear me? Okay.
Yeah.
By yourself. That's scary. But at the same time, here's where I get even weirder. And I'll give you a little background about myself. You might find this interesting.
Okay.
I've always lay on the straight side of the sexual preference spectrum. However, my friends and I, in high school in particular, found ourselves like taking this sort of strange teenage rebellious pleasure in particularly freaking out the alpha males in our class, the high school football guys, into making them think we were gay and that we were going to kiss them. We, like, scared the crap out of them with fake kisses, because we weren't afraid of man kissing. We weren't particularly going for it. Well, some of us actually...
Oh, no, I understand. Scaring straight people's great. I love it.
and I'm a relatively straight guy, and yet I still enjoy it, because any sort of pushing back against normans being normative in your gender or your sexual preference or whatever really just bugged the crap out of us in high school. We hated the fact that we were told what we were supposed to be, so we pushed back against it in sort of a passive-aggressive, homoerotic way. And I still have that. Here I am, 38, and I'm just excited about the idea of the ESRB having to play your game and say, yep, we're letting this on consoles. We're letting penis on consoles, guys. We're doing it.
Oh, yeah, they'd have to rate it, huh?
They totally have to rate it. And as I've gathered, working for Destructoid, I get in these conversations, whether I like to or not, about censorship all the time. Uh-huh. Some people think I'm pro-censorship. Some people think I'm not pro-censorship enough. It's very hard to keep everybody happy. But one thing I've always stood by is that it's not critics like Feminist Frequency and whatnot that are keeping games from finding their audiences and being sold. She criticizes Grand Theft Auto 5, and that becomes the most popular game ever. The people who are stopping games from finding their audiences and, in a sense, silencing them or censoring them is the ESRB. If you put a hard penis in a video game, forget it. Good luck selling that game anywhere other than, the dark corners of the internet. You can blow off heads. You can have not so much vaginas. I think they're scared by them, too. But you can have boobs and butts and sex scenes and The Witcher.
Yeah,
100%
nipple, yeah.
Yeah, 100% nipple. Thank you.
I think the BBC has a similar thing. They have that test where a penis can't be more erect than, like, this one part of, like, Finland. Or something. I forget what it's called. It's like the whole mole of like Kentmeyer or something test. Or it's
really?
Just like, well, it's like an urban legend thing, but a lot of people think it's real. Yeah, like the penis can't be more, it's like more than like 10 degrees or something. So
if it's pointing straight down, rated R. If it's just a little bit alive,
yeah,
or
like,
it has
like,
any
okay,
thoughts.
Okay, oh God, totally inappropriate. Like, terrible.
What do you make of that? I mean, we're probably the two of us a bit biased, and I want to hear the opposing side of it. I want to understand why an erect penis is more dangerous for people to see than heads being blown off, or you know, women being sexually assaulted, or all these other things you can have in a rated R movie. But hard penis is a disaster, rated X or adults only if you're talking games.
Yeah, I would say there's like a double standard as it comes to like sexuality or sexuality and gender and like violence and stuff. I don't know what my opinion is. I guess I don't care. I guess I kind of like the idea of being banned. Oh, okay. So like recently, I was told Twitch banned Cobra Club.
Yeah, and if I remember correctly, it's like one of, is there like a Cobra Club code almost? Like any game like Cobra Club will be banned or something like that.
Kind of. As far as I can tell, it's games with like hardcore sex, except Cobra Club is so softcore. I don't even...
Well, for people who haven't played it, maybe you can describe what Cobra Club is, what you do in it, what you
see.
Oh,
right. Okay, so Cobra Club is a short game about dick pics. And you take dick pics. It's like a first-person kind of dick pic game. You're like holding your phone in the mirror in the bathroom. And it's free, and you can go buy... Actually, I can't even charge money for it because PayPal has pretty strict rules against certain sexual content, which usually means the sexual content they decide is too much or whatever. So I actually don't even accept any donations for it, actually. And that's actually a huge issue with how money is available for people of like sexualities that aren't like acceptable and stuff.
Well, yeah, and maybe I'm missing something. If you can describe Cobra Club a little bit more, do you sex with anybody in that?
No, there is no sex at all. I mean, it's kind of sexy in a certain way, but I wouldn't say there's. So you're in your bathroom and you have your phone and stuff and you take pictures and stuff of your dick. Or you can take pictures of like the toilet paper or something. The game is okay with that. Or you can like do like a really nicely like framed and composed dick pic where like the like a tilted angle or something, like an action pose or something, and then you can apply like filters to it and stuff. So you know, you take dick pics and basically just have fun with dick pics. And it's just some good, clean dick pic fun, as far as I'm concerned.
And is it the dicks then? Are if your dick's pointed down 100% of the time, and if I remember correctly, sometimes
there is an erection slider. You're correct. Right, there's a special slider to make it go up and down. Yeah.
So your options in the game are erection slider, filters on your pictures,
also like angle. Yeah, also like ball size, ball dropping ratio, girth, also I think that's it. I wanted to do like a pube slider, but I ran out of time, decided not to do that.
So it was the sequel.
People were really angry that I didn't have a foreskin option.
I was just
going
to ask about that.
I wanted to. I have a foreskin myself, TMI, but also it's just like, I don't know, like the way I did the glands on the penis was like in a really weird way where it's just like on top of it. So it's actually really, it's hard to like get this like, I don't know, it just wasn't really working the way I did it, and I didn't anticipate doing foreskin support. So, but people
Does
really...
Does Indiegogo allow for funding of foreskin support? I don't think Kickstarter does, but you may be able to go through other channels in order to do the upgrade. Oh, no.
Maybe. Maybe in the future. I want to patch that in. Also, a lot of it inspired by a book called Critique, where the woman who runs that website, she has a very specific idea as to, like, hands are very important in dick pics, and I have no hand control in this game. So I need to add hand control. Yeah, I have a whole laundry list of stuff I have to add. Also, there's a bug where it replaces your dick with, like, a disco ball. I don't understand. I get, like, I see images of it, of the bug. I can't reproduce it. I don't know what's going on. It's kind of cool, but it makes people upset because then they can't take dick pics.
People sincerely like or sometimes even love the premise and the execution of this game. That must be a pretty amazing feeling.
Yeah, it got a pretty good response. I think a lot of people kind of understood what it was kind of going for. And like whenever you make games or like any kind of art, you know, you're always kind of scared whether like, oh, is my intent going to come through or was I full of bullshit and this is just going to fall flat on like delivery or something. And it's always kind of nice when people are like, oh yeah, no, yeah, I can kind of see what you're going for with this. And you're like, oh, no, thank God, okay.
And you can send the dick pics. Am I remembering that right?
Yes, there's a very vastly over-engineered like chat interface where you basically talk with like they're basically Twitter bots, chat bots, but they're in the world of the game, they're like other dick pic connoisseurs. So you chat with them, they'll send you their dick pics. And then you'll reciprocate and send some of your own dick pics over. Sometimes they'll have, like, certain requests, like, oh, can you send me a Marxist dick? And you'll be like, what's a Marxist dick? This is how you make a dick, I guess. So you do these hand gestures. And then you send that pic, and then they'll comment on it and stuff. And also, so very specific, not to add any, like, shaming, really. They'll usually say really cool, interesting things about, they'll have really insightful things to say about your dick pics, usually.
Did that take a lot of time to make sure that the dick pic comments were insightful?
No, it's really random. I'm a really weirdly, like, superstitious developer in some ways, where when I'm not... if I can do something like two or three different ways, I'll usually just make it random. Mm. So like some people will get that first way, some people will get it that third way. And then that way I kind of like get everything I want. People get like unique experiences or whatever. And I kind of can let like the ghost in the machine, I'm letting like the computer kind of collaborate in what the game is.
Right.
So I like randomizing things a lot, and that the chat is pretty much super randomized.
Right, but with some steering towards positivity, it sounds like. It would be harder for it to send a random, I hate your dick, get your dick away from me comment.
Oh, yeah. Oh, you can totally tell them to fuck off and stuff. Which is totally your prerogative, and just block them. On the
you can block them, but they won't block you.
They'll block you usually when they've, like, seen enough dick, or, like... or maybe they have to go abruptly or something. Sometimes they'll sign off or block you or whatever.
Sure.
But yeah, I seed it with content, with a list of words that are just, some of them aren't necessarily positive or negative. Some of them are just weird, like Marxist or like environmental or like ionic. When PewDiePie played it, he got ionic. And he was like, what does that mean? I don't even know what that means. So I wouldn't know what an ionic dick is.
Yeah, is that possible? Like ionic pentameter, right?
No, that's iambic.
I mixed up my iambics and my ionic.
I think ionic as in the Greek architectural order of ionic. I don't know why I put that in there. But that's kind of the fun of making games. You know, you just, like, put a bunch of stuff in there, and then it kind of works sometimes. And you just kind of let it go, kind of let it be its own thing, you know? It's like parenthood, you know? You have to let your babies fly or something.
Absolutely you do. And with this particular baby, was it your intention to allow those who want to take dick pics but are afraid that if they do it, they're going to feel some shame or feel some regret or do it wrong? This is like a safe way to play with the idea of being a dick pic taker.
Yeah, I would kind of agree. Like, yeah, it was kind of intended to be this kind of safe thing, this inclusive thing. Maybe you don't have a dick. Mm. Well, it's totally wrong that you're not allowed to take dick pics if you don't have a dick. So this game will allow you to do that and like explore that kind of part of yourself. It's also kind of about, and this is something like an ideology I got from Critique My Dick Pic, that Tumblr, where she's kind of about, dick pics should be very, there's a certain type of dick pic she is very negative about. So she gives very good criticism. It's always very honest, thoughtful criticism, but not necessarily always positive. Because some dick pics are just bad in her mind. Huh. In her mind, the dick pics that are bad are what she calls log pictures, where it's just, you just put your erect dick and it's just taking up the whole frame, and the lighting is really bad and muddy, and you're not really sure what's going on. Like, is that a dick? I don't even know, but it's big. And then it's just not very, like, thoughtful or anything. So I think I wanted to kind of argue for dick pics being thoughtful in all these other ways that maybe don't necessarily have to do with having this giant, like, beer can thing.
Uh-huh. Huh. That, to me, sounds like the next level of sort of legitimizing men expressing not their lust necessarily, but to be... to express their sexuality physically, to put themselves in a position to be lusted after, that our society is so often missing. I've heard more and more people tell me that they feel like it's pushing forward, and it's not something that I pay as much attention to as maybe as I could, as I don't think a ton about it. They don't think a ton about dudes and how sexy they are. Maybe should. But I've heard from people who read comics saying, thank God, they're finally like finding out how to show men in a way that makes them sexy. Particularly, I hear about Dick Grayson all the time. He's the former Robin. In comics these days, he's coming out of the shower, but not like flexing as he's coming out of the shower, but kind of like putting his thumbs on his towel a little bit, like maybe the towel is going to come off. And women, in particular, and also men, are saying, like, finally, they're getting it. We don't want to just see Wolverine, like, killing a guy, and we want to have sex with that. We want to have sex with someone, a guy who's soft and vulnerable, but also confident and aware that they can show their sexuality and share their sexuality, be comfortable with it, not see it as so much a weapon, which it seems like there's this other side of society that is so scared of the erect penis, sees it as a weapon, and it's like more dangerous to put that in your game or your movie than headshots.
I mean, an erect penis can totally be a weapon, and it often is used as a weapon. But I think, I don't know, I'm not necessarily like, I think I am interested in this idea of like what a masculine body image is, you know, and like what that kind of ideal is. Like, I think most of my games, I mean, up until like Cobra Club, have featured kind of like these like hunky white dudes, basically. Mm-hmm. And that's actually a huge problem in the gay community. Racism is a huge problem. Mm-hmm. So I think I'm kind of in my games now, like the current game I'm making now is a like shower game where you wash this guy. And you wash this guy and he's like super muscly and stuff. But I'm also adding in this kind of body awareness thing where you have your body attached to the first person camera and you can look down at your own body, and your own body is not really muscly at all. It's probably more like my body, quite frankly. It's kind of it's okay to feel kind of awkward about your body. It's kind of supposed to be about that. I think I'm trying to make bodies a little bit more awkward. I'm kind of interested in Cobra Club, there's a special feature that you can like unlock called glitch dick mode, where it turns your penis, makes your penis start like spinning and go like 100 miles per hour, like this like jet turbine engine thing. And that's okay, because this isn't a real body, right? This is a weird video game fake body, which is kind of funny. So why not treat it like this weird fake body? Same thing kind of with Hurt Me Plenty, my spanking game, or with Succulent, my popsicle eating game. There's always kind of some point in the game where bodies suddenly start kind of like deforming and stuff. Because I'm not interested in trying to be this like perfect photorealistic image. I want to kind of find that that notion of the uncanny valley in computer graphics, right? That, like, when human bodies are kind of close to realistic, kind of photorealistic kind of levels, they get kind of creepy and doll-like, like dead zombies or cadavers or something. Sure. I kind of want to find that uncanny valley, and I guess, like, dive into it and, like, plunge to the bottom of an uncanny valley a little bit. And I think that's interesting because bodies are kind of uncanny and creepy. We're pretending kind of they're not, that they're this perfect, comfortable thing, and they're not always.
No. They work against us more often than not, in my opinion. And to treat them as though they're to be idealized in and of themselves gets a lot of people in a lot of trouble. But to have a sense of humor about them, but still have affection towards them. And that's the sense I'm getting. I mean, it's hard to imagine you don't have some affection for the male body as a theory, because you've made so many games that pay tribute to it in such nice ways, games that other people wouldn't necessarily dare to make games, but it, you know, hurt me plenty. I don't know if you are attracted to, or at least think that the guys in your games are attractive, but they seem pretty charming to me.
Yeah, I would say they're kind of like, if I saw guys that type in, like, real life, I probably wouldn't talk to them because I'd, like, assume all these terrible personality flaws of them or something. But I think they kind of do represent a different type of, like, body ideal. Like, I think a lot of people who say, like, oh, male bodies are just as objectified in games are kind of missing the point where it's like, no, they're not really objectified because they might be naked and strong and idealized, but they're not necessarily objectified because they're still in, like, these, like, positions of power, and they're not necessarily, like, particularly, like, sexy. Like, they're kind of just, like, too buff. A lot of men in games are just way too buff for my taste. Sure. So I think a lot of the dudes in my games are meant to be kind of, like, muscly and stuff, but kind of more realistically muscly, kind of more what you might see in, like, some gay porn or something. Something that's kind of more... the reference I gave the modeler, the 3D artist, actually, was the Dante in the new Devil May Cry reboot. I would say, like, he kind of represents this kind of different body image that is kind of, like, catering more towards people who are attracted to masculinity, I would say.
Interesting. I'm curious about what you might assume, like, if you met the Hurt Me Plenty guy or the Succulent guy at a club. It doesn't sound like you'd be immediately repulsed by him physically, but you might immediately make some guesses about what kind of guy he would be. What kind of guesses might you make?
I guess I would assume, I don't know, like, attractive people are just so darn attractive sometimes. It just makes you really, like this is something, like when you see an ad and they're just wearing really ugly clothes, but it doesn't even matter because they're attractive and it doesn't even matter what they wear. So then you're like, oh God, I hate that attractive person who can wear really ugly stuff and doesn't really care, but it doesn't matter because they have, like, impeccable bone structure or whatever. So I don't know, like, I'm friends with plenty of wonderful, attractive people. I wouldn't say, like, I hate attractive people.
No, I didn't get that sense at all.
But I would say there's kind of, like, a different, like, you know, power dynamic at play here. And these games, like, center attractive people, but not to, like, put them in positions of power. It's more to, like, play with them or mess with them or have fun with them, have this kind of interesting video game interaction conversation with them or something.
Yeah. But they are pretty attractive, the guys you've modeled.
Yeah, I would say they're designed to be read as attractive. Whether you find them attractive or not personally is up to you.
Sure, of course. So it speaks to a larger issue I've thought about for a whole heck of a long time, and I don't know why, and I don't think these thoughts are ever going to go anywhere, but here they are, still got them. This place in between objectifying and identifying with the characters we play in a video game. Like, for me, being on the straighter side of the spectrum, playing something.
I believe
like
you're straight. You're straight. Good job. But keep going. Keep going. Sorry.
Maybe it's not even worth mentioning, but just in case, throwing it out there. poor Robert, talking to me. Playing Resident Evil Revelations. Looking at Jill Valentine's butt. You think, wow, that's a heck of a butt. That's not like my butt. I'm not identifying with that butt, thinking like, yeah, she's me right now. I am that woman's butt. You think that's the kind of butt that I would objectify and think I want that butt near me as a thing that I can rub. I want to rub that butt. And then you're playing as her, and then you're not thinking about rubbing her butt. You're thinking about being her, being the being that woman who's in that threatening situation. Right. And I've heard many game developers, most recently, Koji Igarashi, the creator of Bloodstained, and he did a lot of Castlevania games, he thinks putting a woman as his lead character will make men care about her more, because they are objectifying her, but in a way that they want to care for her. But at the same time, they think they would want to be her too, because she's powerful and cool and whatnot. I don't know if that's the same for you, if you have to think about the line between identifying the characters in your game, the player identifying with them, or just objectifying them.
Yeah, I would say, actually there's something I'm interested in thinking about for the current game I'm working on right now, the shower game. So in the shower game, there's like a hunk, should I like give it away kind of? I'll kind of give it away. So there's this like hunky dude in the shower or something, and then you like wash him basically with like a sponge and stuff, and it's all sudsy and like beefcakey and showery and stuff. And I feel like the argument that I'm gonna present, at least, that he's in a position of power, is that if you like scrub the wrong way, he's going to get like impatient with you and be like, never mind, I'm not going to let you wash me anymore. Huh. Or to a certain aspect, it'll be like he tells you specifically what parts of him he wants you to wash. And if you don't do what he says, he's going to be like, oh, you're not giving me what I want? Okay, well, I'm not going to let myself be washed by you. So I feel like in those questions of like objectification or like agency in games and stuff, you have to consider kind of the general context of what that character is actually doing in the game. If the Jill Valentine character is like over the shoulder or whatever, and you're not even really looking at her butt at all or something, she just happens to have a really great ass or something, I guess that's like more on the okay side or something. I don't know. I guess it's just a hypothetical. I don't even know. But if you're playing something like Tomb Raider, right, where like I was playing one of the Tomb Raiders recently. I forget which one it was. Where when you get out of the pool, like the camera really just cranes back to like really zoom in on her like wet, glowing. Her butt is pretty much glowing. Her like wet, glowing butt, and it's just like shining at you. I would say that's pretty like male gaze, G-A-Z-E kind of a thing going, and you're definitely kind of objectifying. I think it's like context. I don't think there's any like hard fast rules as to like, okay, oh, 5 points for this camera angle, but -10 for doing this thing, right? It's going to be really like contextual, and it'll depend on what players think and what the creator thinks and stuff. And it's supposed to make these games more interesting to like talk about, right? It's not about saying this media is not feminist, this media is inappropriate, do not consume this media, right? It's more just about like, oh, wow, that's weird. How does this reflect on my own life? I'm not sure how Tomb Raider would reflect on my own life, but if it did, I'm sure Tomb Raider fans can like tie it back to their own personal experience. And I think that's what a lot of this conversation is supposed to be about, and how these games might reflect kind of societal norms and reality. It's not about saying don't play Tomb Raider, boycott Tomb Raider and stuff. I don't, at least from my end, that's not my aim when I say these things.
Yeah, and I don't hear a ton of that. I hear people who will have really harsh criticisms of games that they feel do more to objectify human beings than to make them subjects that you care about and empathize with and identify with. But they never say, stop these games from existing. They say, let's have this conversation so we can be aware of what we're doing. We're all going to objectify each other at some point. And it's not something to be ashamed of, I don't think. And it's not something to run away from the topic of either, to face it and have an interesting conversation about what it's like to be a human being interacting with other human beings, be they virtual human beings you're washing or the virtual butts you're watching come out of the shower as they glow. I want to see this now. Sounds pretty hilarious. Which brings me back to another point that we touched upon already, but I'm still wanting to dig a little further. This whole concept of your games being funny to people, and particularly to straight people. Like, how do you feel about it when people take your games as kind of laughing at male sexuality? Is Snooki doing something? Is he interrupting you?
Yeah, Snooki's just washing something. it's okay. it's okay, Snooki, apologize. What was the question? Oh, straight people.
Your game says comedy, not so much them being straight up homophobic, because the answer to that is pretty clear. Anyone who's propping up your game as an opportunity to say that there's something bad about being gay, of course that's gross. But just straight people whom, and this is the criticism, again, I got for propping up that Rhythm Heaven Fever meme a little bit. People, gay men were telling me, you're making fun of us without realizing it. You don't appreciate it. You're saying that to be gay is to be laughed at, like Big Mama's House or some comedy about a man dressing like a woman as though that's hilarious instead of just a thing that happens.
Right. I wouldn't equate that with like Big Mama's House or something.
no, not the best example.
So like, God, that clock is on fire. I feel like... Like, my games are kind of meant to be funny, partly because I think sex is kind of funny, and we should allow sex to be kind of funny, and sex is all these things. Sex is funny, sex is really hot and serious, sex is sometimes dangerous, you know, like, sex can be all these things. I don't know, I would say... straight people are okay? What was the question?
That was a fine answer. It may be a question that's just not that interesting, and that's totally okay with me. The question was, you know, does it bother you when straight people use your game as kind of a joke? To be like, haha, men think they're sexual, but we know they're not because we're straight men. Isn't that hilarious?
I think it depends. Why you're laughing, I guess. Mm-hmm. I think, like, people can definitely be laughing for, like, weird or kind of gross reasons. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, I'm not going to be, like, the laughter police. I'm not going to, like, if someone laughs in my game, I'm not going to be like, why are you laughing? You better answer correctly. I think when you make stuff, it's okay to let, like, the response to work hurt you, especially if it's like personal work or autobiographical work. But at the same time, personally, my games I wouldn't consider to be super autobiographical, really. So I have personally have this distance with them. Mm-hmm. So if someone says this game sucks and you're a bad person, I'm like, okay, yeah, that's just a game I made. You know, it's not me, so. It's okay if you don't like this game. So, you know, I'm kind of unusual, I guess, in that I don't really... I maintain some kind of distance, at least internally or emotionally in my head when I make
these things. Have you always, though? Like, if you think back to some of the first games you made public, did it hurt a little bit more or feel a little more personal? Because that's, I'm guessing, all you had at that point. You thought... well, this game is 100% of games I have put out there and made. And everything I am as a game developer rides on how this one goes over, as opposed to now, looking at your page, if I remember correctly, there was more than 20 games on there, if not more.
Yeah, that's inflated. No, those aren't real games. Well, I would say, like, these games are personal, but not in, like, a memoir kind of way for me. They're kind of personal in, like, a different way where, like, I made these games because no one, I felt like if I didn't make them, no one else was going to. And I kind of put myself off from making, I didn't want to be pigeonholed as that guy who makes gay games now. But I think December 2014, I was just like, I don't know, I guess I shouldn't be waiting for people to make the games I want to see made. So I guess I should just make them. And it's okay if all my future interactions with people are always going to be about gay sex now. There are much worse things, interactions to have with people, I guess. So I guess I just kind of accepted that. My games are, like, personal in, like, weird, small, secret, personal, private ways. Mm-hmm. It's never going to be, like, I'm making this shower game because I had this experience in a shower. You know, I never had that experience in a shower. I don't even go to the gym, so I would never have that experience in the shower. But they're personal in, like, a different way, in that they kind of speak to something I've been thinking about or something that happened to friends of mine or so on.
Sure. But it doesn't sound like you're thinking these games are like a flag. Like, they're not like the Robert Yang flag that represents everything you are. They're thoughts, feelings, ideas you had. And we're not necessarily proud or ashamed of the thoughts, feelings, ideas we had. We just had them and we put them out there for people. That's how it sounds anyway. Do you want to talk more about the games you made before 2014? Certainly wouldn't want to. I don't think of you as just a guy who makes games about hot dudes and sex. I think of you as a guy who's exploring all sorts of stuff.
So the games I was working on before were kind of more... I mean, I think for the longest time, I think a lot of indie developers also sympathize with this. I had it in my head that I had to kind of make kind of commercially oriented things that would speak to my personal artistic sensibilities somehow, while also selling 100,000 units or on Steam somehow or something.
Sure.
So for a while, I was kind of aimed on that kind of like compromise and trying to have it all and stuff. And a lot of my attempted work was really commercially oriented. And I think some people work really well that way, and they rise to that occasion. I guess I, in the end, didn't really. So I worked on a game called, making a game called Nostrum. That came from me watching the Miyazaki film Porco Rosso and thinking it would make a really cool, like, open world game. I'm still kind of working on it. I still want to go back to it. But maybe after like five more sex games. So that game was actually for an Oculus VR jam that they run at IndieCade. And Oculus has been really great. I placed second in the competition, which is a lot better than I thought I was going to do. And Oculus is just, like, super nice. They, like, still, like, email me and talk to me and send me stuff, so that's nice. And that game, you're like someone flying around in a plane in, like, a Mediterranean ocean, and, like, it was supposed to be, like, a flight simulator virtual reality thing for people who didn't really like hardcore flight simulators. It was supposed to be pretty comfortable. Kind of more like Animal Crossing meets, like, Crimson Skies or whatever that game's called.
Sounds amazing.
I thought it was a cool pitch. And I worked on it, and I also thought it was going to have, like, a cool, like, World War II kind of, it's going to be set during World War II. And one thing I really like about Porco Rosso is that it's set during this, it's like this like fascist backdrop to it, and that kind of like colors all the events in it, but it's not really about that. I kind of wanted that kind of same effect here. I feel like a lot of games about war aren't really about war, in that they're kind of more about this weird fantasy of war, about like symmetrical sides operating in this like contained arena with no like collateral damage and stuff. So I want this to be like an Animal Crossing open world flight sim thing, but all your friends like die. I wanted like you to like make like friends with all these people on this island, and then suddenly the war breaks out and that town is bombed into like nothing and all those cute animals are just gone forever.
Wow.
So I wanted to be like, okay, the better pitch I had was Animal Crossing meets Animal Farm.
But in a plane.
But not like plane. In a plane.
Yeah,
Porco Rosso or whatever. So that's still kind of like near to my heart, and I'm still working on that, kind of in my mind. I totally want to go back to it, but right now VR development's a little bit of a mess, so I think I'm going to wait a few more months for it to like mature a bit more to the APIs and stuff, and then
sure.
I'll go back.
Would it have to be a solely VR experience, or do you think it might work without VR as well?
No, it would be like screen-based too. You can totally play it with just regular mouse look, first-person stuff. But it's also, I feel like it would be like a slow flight sim, which doesn't sound good. But I feel like a lot of people don't, when they're making VR stuff, they're not really thinking about how interesting it is to just look around at stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's always two ends of the spectrum with a lot of VR stuff being made today. It's either VR stuff where it's supposed to be like, oh, you're a space fighter. Like, there's 20 space fighter games right now where you're supposed to be, like, going at the speed of light and stuff, and it's going to be really cool in this cockpit. And then there's the game where, like, you're going to sit in this room, and you're just going to look around at stuff happening. I want something kind of in the middle of those two sensibilities, and I think that's possible. But maybe I'll be finished with that in like a year or something or two. I don't know.
Still not bad compared to most game development cycles. How much can you do in it now? Can you fly in it and go to an island and whatnot?
There's like a fully functioning prototype where you fly around, you visit islands. There's like a light narrative about where you have to find your wingman because your wingman crashed and you're trying to track him down or something. And then there's like an ending where you kind of find out what happened and stuff.
Oh,
it is like a fully featured demo. I just kind of had more ambitions for it before I wanted to release it publicly. And I still want to do that, but it's going to take a little while.
I'm sorry, I missed the last word in there.
Oh, but it's just going to take a while.
I didn't hear that.
Trailed off.
Yeah, no, you did.
That's okay.
Well, now that you have a fan base in Japan and the United States of, you know, hundreds of thousands potentially, PewDiePie is playing your games, you could throw that on Kickstarter, I would imagine, and ask for $50,000. And it's I think, realistic that you would be able to get it, especially with the pitch you just gave me. I would love to play a game where I have flown a plane, and then I get off the plane, and I look in a mirror, and I see that I'm a pig. That alone would blow my mind. I knew I was playing something that was inspired by one of my favorite movies, and a lot of people's favorite, one of their favorite movies, Porco Rosso. I don't like the dub that much. I hate to be a stickler, but I tell you.
Oh, I like it. Actually.
Do you?
I think I've only seen the dub, actually.
Well, that's the thing. I first saw that movie. My Japanese teacher in college took a liking to me. I'm very lucky. She let me borrow a VHS tape of it that was just taped off Japanese TV. And I watched that, like, every day, just totally in love with that world and how it looked and how it felt to be there, both under so much threat, but in this, like, peaceful, serene heaven of a Mediterranean island world. Such a neat dichotomy there, which it sounds like what you want to go for. You want to give people like this cartoonish heaven and then blow it up.
Yeah, and I think that's kind of what I like. That's what makes it my favorite Miyazaki movie. I feel like a lot of his stuff is like really like epic and like sweeping, and I like how Porco Rosso's like the side quest to that, right? Like, it could have been a story about how he changes the tide of the war and stuff, right? But it isn't. He's just a pig trying to survive, just like all the other pigs. So
yeah, that's right.
So I kind of liked how it's like a small story in like a big setting, and I think And the ending also stuck with me too. I really liked the ending. It was kind of like ambiguous too. I liked that.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think if I remember correctly, that was originally supposed to be like a 20-minute short film, kind of like that music video he did and the Cat Bus short he did for the Ghibli Museum. But he liked it so much, he just blew it out and made it into a feature. So in a lot of ways, that's like the most Miyazaki movie, from what I'm told. He just made it as a passion project and really put himself in there. So yeah, you could do the same thing with your game. That would be fun. It'd make me happy.
it'd make me happy too. He made, I also read he based Porco Rosso off this Roald Dahl short story. And I like read the short story. So Roald Dahl was like that famous children's author and stuff. He was also like a RAF pilot. So he wrote these like kind of adult short stories about flying military missions and stuff. Huh. And one of the stories is pretty clearly an inspiration for Porco Rosso. And it's kind of, it's good. He like kind of maintained the tone a lot from the story. It's interesting.
I had no idea. I'll look that up. Speaking of influences and whatnot, were there any games that influenced you growing up? Did you play video games growing up? You said you like making them more than you like playing them for the most part, but I don't know if that was always the case.
My favorite games. I really liked the... I feel like I should have answers for this. The Thief series was really formative for me. Like when I played Thief 1, I think I pirated it off Kazaa or Morpheus in one of those file sharing things, and they also omitted all the NPC sounds. So Thief, it's like a first-person sneaking game where you're supposed to like listen to all these guards, and then I always just thought it was weird how this world was just so like they would never say anything. Like it was just this world of like the city and like footsteps, and they would never talk. So I thought it was just such a like a fascinating like game. I was like, wow, I really like this place. But it was because I pirated a really bad version of it. What else was really formative for me? I really liked, I actually got into level design because I played, this little game called Counter-Strike.
It's pretty popular.
Yeah, it has some followers. And then I was playing that, and I was like, oh, you can make worlds in this? Oh, that's kind of cool. And then I learned that there's a mod of Counter-Strike called Half-Life 1, and I played some Half-Life 1, and I was like, oh, you can tell, like, stories with worlds, too. That's kind of interesting. So that's kind of how I got into that. So those two games were kind of formative for me, too.
Huh. How old were you then when you played those?
I think I was in, like, junior high or high school or something.
Oh, wow. I forgot how much younger you probably are than me. Are you, like, 25?
Yeah, I'm a fetus. I'm really young compared to my colleagues. But it's okay. I'm an old soul or something. Or that's what I say sometimes.
You could be anywhere from 18 to 95 in my opinion. So congrats.
My students usually guess I'm 30.
Really? Seems a little old.
And then I'm a little offended, but then I'm like, okay, no, I guess I do hold myself in like very like dignified wise.
Well, sure, you're a professor already. I'm sure they want to imagine that you're quite a bit older than them, so they don't feel as bad about themselves that they're not even close to them.
Maybe I should like project more onto them.
Sure. Yeah, make them feel good. Hey, I'm so old. It took me so long to get here. Don't worry about it. You'll be making games about spanking guys in a few years and you'll be very successful, just like me.
You're not old. You're 30-something, right?
Who, me?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I am 30-something, but much closer to 40. I'm going to be 40 in a year and a half. I am old. It is true.
But all my 40-year-old friends tell me that you only reach... Like, they feel like they're at the peak of their powers, actually, at 40.
You know what I've heard is that everybody always thinks they're at the peak of their powers, whatever age they're at. And they're, like, just on the cusp of getting old, but I'm not quite there yet. Everyone always feels that way by some study I read.
So, oh, really?
Yeah. Yeah. So it goes with you. You always think that you're like the normal age and that everyone else is either too old or too young by comparison. I definitely think in the video game world, I'm old, and that I have seen trends come and go that other people that I talk to about video games pretty regularly are like, what are you even talking about? Like, there's, if you're 38 and you're involved in video games, you've seen mega franchises be like a thing that's just normal that everyone plays, completely die, and then new ones start and then die again. Like, I was around for Tiffany and Debbie Gibson. You probably don't even know who they were, but people, there
those
was
are names. Okay.
They used to be, you know, the Kim Kardashian and whatever woman is a popular pop singer now. They were like as big as it got, and I've seen game franchises come and go as well. So yeah, makes me feel old. And I've seen this progression towards inclusiveness in video games, which has been really neat. I'm old enough to remember when you would never see anyone looking even remotely anything but white and straight in a video game forever. And now that's it seems to finally be changing, I think. Maybe.
I'm thinking things are getting better, like, generally in a sense. I think a lot of that is kind of, like, that's, like, maybe the good side of, like, indies, of, like, the indie movement or whatever you want to call it, kind of skewing more towards, like, young people. Mm-hmm. Maybe that's, like, the nice side of it, but maybe, like, the less nice side of it is that, like, so many young people are, like, growing up publicly on the internet. Kind of, which is maybe why there's maybe what people might call like indie drama or something. You know, we're young and investing a lot of our emotions in this thing because this is what we know, this is what we're growing up as. So I think this is usually what I have to like explain to older people who like look at the younger people and think like, oh, why are you fighting about this? This is silly. And then I usually have to say, like, no, we're young. Let us grow up. You know, like, when you were our age, you were fighting about stupid shit, too, probably. So, I think that's just part of it, and that's kind of the good and bad side of it. And or maybe it's neither good nor bad. It just is what it is.
Well, it's something that comes up a lot with the internet, and I've been thinking about it a ton the past couple weeks because people have been very, very upset at me. About an issue I won't trouble you with. It's got to do with this game Fire Emblem that's not even out here. Some people are mad at Destructoid for saying that we're homophobic, and other people are mad at us for saying we aren't like homophobic enough or something along those lines. Like we're not on a either pole enough, I guess. Something that keeps coming up is like, why are people getting so mad at you about this? People on the sidelines are watching people saying that I'm like offending them and hurting them, and I didn't even do anything. It's just I'm the editor-in-chief of a website that did something that hurt them, and therefore that's on me. Fair enough. And what I say back in actually defense of the people that are angry at me is like, video games are important now. Like to just walk away from them is to, you only walk away from things you don't care about. Like, and people often say, oh, there's someone's getting bullied on the internet. Well, that's not real bullying. They should just close their eyes and walk away. Well, if the internet and the human beings in your world that you interact with through the internet are important to you, if you've invested something and had positive experiences there, you can't just toss that out and say, oh, well, nobody matters on the internet to me anymore. I'll just close my eyes. It doesn't hurt. If we're going to think that other people are important at all and use the internet as a tool to convey that importance, things are going to hurt sometimes. And I certainly don't want to hurt anybody out there. And if I have, I want to apologize. But I wouldn't discount people who are getting filled with this drama, this indie drama you're talking about, this young people drama. It's for real, because this is what you're really doing with your life.
I would agree with that. Like, this is our life. It's on the internet, and the internet is like part of our life like that, right? The internet is just like a place. And then games are function like those places too, right? Like, you might not play golf anymore, right? You might instead go on a World of Warcraft raid with your boss or something instead of playing golf or something. And then you have to give your boss that really great rare equipment or something, and then that's like the translation or something, right? So maybe, I don't know, I think as people kind of shift their understandings of like games as places or worlds to like hang out in, I think people will understand more that the emotions tied to these places are like real and valid and stuff.
Sure, I hope so. Discounting feelings is always something that bugs me. And at the same time, I'm not saying like, I'm glad you're mad at me and you have every right to be mad at me. Like, I don't want people to be mad, and I honestly don't think it's that constructive to be starting fights and whatnot. Better to have just an exchange of ideas and not try to put other people down or push down their perspectives or whatever. But all the same, I admire the passion, and I'm happy people care about video games enough to get passionate about them. Shows that they are kind of a big deal. You don't seem like you were ever a nerd, Robert. Not to use it.
What?
Yeah. You know, start.
What do you mean by that? I don't.
With Thief and Half-Life 2.
Is that nerdy?
No, I don't think so. Like, if you had told me that you were like the only kid who loves Sonic the Hedgehog or Final Fantasy or something like that, then I'd be like, okay, maybe it's just an age thing. But it seems like you are maybe young enough that video games were never uncool for your world. I don't know.
Yeah, I guess, like in high school, I didn't really get, like, picked on. Like, high school was actually just, like, okay for me. I didn't really, I think I was, like, the king of one dance, too. I wouldn't say I was, like, nerdy. I don't know. What's the opposite of a nerd?
I think, like, an alpha male, maybe.
Alpha male,
yeah. I'm not sure. From what I know, and again, this is another thing I've given probably too much thought, a nerd is anyone who like fails to meet whatever our milestones of masculinity are. So you know, being muscular, being sports focused, being like confident and aggressive and like going after money and going after power. If you're someone who's just satisfied to like be fascinated with the world of bugs or the world of video games, the world of books, and you don't worry about working out or expressing power or dominance on other things, then you're probably going to get labeled as a nerd. It doesn't sound like you were.
I would like sit at home and like make believe 3D worlds and like code. I don't know. Those strike me as kind of nerdy.
I don't know if they are anymore. Some of the
tennis. Tennis is kind of nerdy to me.
No, what?
I ran tennis cross is country. Nerdy? Cross country is kind of nerdy.
Tennis and cross country are like man endurance. Like what? I've got the muscle to go all
the
way.
No, they're not contact sports.
They don't have to be.
Football. American football.
Well, yeah, football would be more on that, but any sort of
Masculinity doesn't value endurance, I would say.
You don't think so?
I would say it's more about like, oh, good job, you can run a marathon, oh, good for you. Oh, well, you can pull that truck with your teeth, oh, you're a man. I don't know. I think I think it's different. It's okay if we have different ideas of masculinity, though.
Absolutely it does. I'm happy to exchange them with you. And it is more of a spectrum than it is or is not masculine. And I would say cross-country and tennis are much closer to ideal masculine than what I was doing, which was trying to speed run Super Metroid alone at age, so however old I was when that came out, 18 or whatever. I played that way too many hours.
No, it seems pretty I can't imagine speed running anything.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, it seems so, like, kind of like macho and, like, posturing, almost as if you're, like, compensating for like some kind of latent sexuality, but also it's so like direct. I feel like speedrunning is really cool in that they like find new ways to like play games and like imagine games and stuff and change our ideas of games, but I always found them so direct, like governed by time. I don't like. I don't have a really quantified sense of time. Like I'm the type of person who gets lost in things, and then doesn't really care at the end.
Sure.
So I don't know. I feel like time is oppressive and masculinity is oppressive. So therefore, focusing on time.
Whoa! You just talked me into thinking I'm masculine. That's shocking. I think that's a first.
No, you're very butch. You're 100% straight. Stamp of approval.
I never said good I was job. 100%. I said on the spectrum I was far over there.
You're 97. I mean,
if we were at, you know, just like reviewing a video game, is it a 9.5 or a 10? It's a very big difference. I was being sarcastic.
That's true.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Poof. We have 7 minutes left. We've talked a lot about your games. Is there anything you wanted to talk about that we didn't get to yet? Because you have so many games. Any games you're particularly proud of, not proud of?
Games. Is there a game we didn't talk about from the Sex series?
I don't think so. Well, we didn't talk as in-depth about Stick Shift, which is the one that I saw the most people treating like a straight comedy game. And I mean straight in both senses of the term. I saw a lot of people seeing that as like a weird sort of mocking male sexuality game, maybe more than the others, and being both mad or not mad about that. Some people thought it was hilarious. We did a Let's Play of it on our Destructoid video channel, actually. Jed Whitaker played it and really got into it.
Mm-hmm.
Really enjoyed it. So, yeah, Stick Shift.
Stick Shift. Oh, yeah, okay, so let's talk about Stick Shift. So Stick Shift recently got greenlit on Steam, which is kind of amazing. Because I kind of just like put it on there and then tweeted it out and then people voted yes for it and now it's going to be on Steam and it's kind of hilarious to me. So Stick Shift, in case for people listening who don't know, Stick Shift is a game where you jack off a car. You have sex with the car. The car is gay. It's a gay car. And the driver is also male, so that's what makes this a gay kind of circle jerk game. So you jack off this car by kind of going up and down on the stick shift, the shifting rod, the gear. I think part of it is kind of fascinating. Part of it came from me being like just formally interested in shifting, like nothing to do with sexuality, like the idea that like that you have to memorize that your body, to drive a manual transmission car, your body has to memorize this like really arbitrary combination of movements until you're not even like thinking consciously about it.
Mm-hmm.
Driving games are usually just about like going as fast as you can around like a track, but driving games are also like driving experience. Driving is so much more than just going around a track, right? It's also about like, oh, where am I going to find a parking space, right? Like, oh God, that's $20? Or if you're in New York City, it's like, oh, alternate side parking. Okay, I have to go move my car, right? Or, like, if you're driving, like, oh, the windshield's dirty, I have to go clean this car and take care of my car now and, like, touch my car in a really expressive way, right? I feel like driving, there's so many different, like, behaviors and gestures tied to it. I wanted to kind of, like, expand that idea of driving, kind of like how I was hopefully expanding sexuality with being autosexual. And it'll hopefully make Steam a gayer place, a steamier place.
Here's what came across for me. I don't know if it came across for the viewers as well, because our connection's breaking up for whatever reason, which makes me sad. But I heard autosexual.
I just keep bulging out.
I think. Yeah. So the extended autosexual I heard was made me happy. And no problems with Steam and the game or PayPal. That's okay, not your fault. because it's not an actual penis you're stroking. It's a shifter. It's a metaphor.
Did any of that come across? Is my internet crapping out?
Yeah, it is crapping out, but a lot of it came across. Not lately, though.
Okay. Oh, well. Sorry.
Okay. Okay. It still sounded... What came across was good. 2 minutes left. Rats. And what I really wanted to...
now or something? Or?
Oh, sometimes we have questions. Sometimes we don't. We have a minute.
Never mind.
That's all right. Gosh darn it. I could talk to you for a lot longer, Robert. There's a lot of stuff that I wanted to know more about, having to do with something we touched about a little, which is how your games are being, at least some of your games, are being considered too sexual for PayPal. Well, mm-hmm. Well, some aren't. There's so much to talk about in there, but we don't have time. Rats. But people can see your games where? Where can they find them?
You can go to my website, which is debacle.us, or you can find me on itch.io. I'm go by Radiator Yang on that, or follow my Twitter at Radiator Yang.
Yes, yes, they can, and they can take classes. You can be taught by Robert Yang.
Take my class. Come to New York City and take my class, and I'll.
Which class? What's the name of the class you're teaching again?
I mostly teach like game development classes, like general Unity coding kind of stuff. They're not how to make gay game classes. Someday, but.
Well, I look forward to that. As for me, I'm at Tron Knots on Twitter. You can watch this show later on YouTube, youtube.com/subhomeshow. You can listen to it on Libsyn and iTunes. You just Google that. You can also, there's a magazine I forgot to mention earlier. We put out a print magazine through Game Fan Magazine. Destructoid is partnered with them. You can get the digital version right now for free. You can also buy the print version if you want. I think it's like $6. You pre-order it. It's pretty neat. Or you can download it. I wrote about Earthbound for a while on there. Okay. Yeah, you like Earthbound at all, Robert?
I tried playing the first 5 minutes, and then I stopped playing. But I'm sure it's a really great game or something. and it's totally cool if you love it.
Yeah, it's totally cool. Or if you don't, you know.
Thanks for having me.